Yeah, I'm trying to get my Bluetooth to work.
All right, everyone. Good evening, social media. Everyone in the virtual room. We are here. We are here. We are here. Good morning, afternoon, evening, everybody out there. How are you today? I am Pastor Teresa Vini, one of the administrators of Soldiers on Fire for Christ. We are here for Soldiers on Fire for Christ monthly meet and greet session. We welcome any of you that will be joining us or trying to join us. And for those of you that may view this later, we extend out that you come and join us. Make time and come and meet us. We're not going to bite y'all. We love to fellowship with God's people. Amen. And so, hopefully one day you will get in here and so you can come because iron sharpens iron and we edify and strengthen one another. So we are all here. We have Minister Rose Christine Jackson and Minister Isaiah Robinson from Lakeland, Florida. We have Elder Marshall Jenkins from Michigan, and we have Brother Bud Dillon from Ohio, two of our missing leaders. We want to keep them in prayer because of family emergency, and that is Apostle Robin Raleigh. She is from Michigan, and Minister Von Sutter Simmons from Savannah, Georgia. Amen. But God, we're confident. You know, we're just confident and excited because even though we all go through a little something at times, but God always get the victory through it as long as we continue to trust and believe in him. And we know that these ladies definitely trust and believe in him. So you God willing, you will see them and be able to meet them next month. But I just want to say we have this every month, every fourth, you know, whatever the month is, because sometimes it's 4 weeks in a month. So every fourth or fifth, the last Tuesday of each month. And it's no excuse why you can't come and meet, because I think I say it all the time, and I know I said it on my message. There are a lot of you out in groups, and y'all don't even know who the creators of the groups is. People done put y'all in stuff, put y'all names in groups, and you ain't never met the people to add me. You don't even know who they is. You know, that's no different than back in the day when church was open. Didn't you do investigation on the churches that you went to? Didn't you find out what they was about? You ain't just roll up in anybody's church, eating from just any place. So come on over and check out Soldiers on Fire for Christ, one of our meet and greet sessions, so you can really see. Like I said, we ain't going to bite you. It's God. This is God's family. We're God family. We're God children. We're family oriented around here. Amen. We got all the time for all the hoopla. Yeah, because guess what? The world and the devil do enough hoopla, so we don't need to do it. They do enough. Amen. They do enough hoopla. Messing around. So before we get started, I know some of you, as always, because some of you work like I do, some of y'all been running. It's Tuesday, definitely only the second day God gave us of the week. You're running, getting off of work, clear your mind, relax. I'm going to just play one praise and worship song. I do not own any rights to the music that will be coming forth. And then I'm going to open us up in prayer. And then you're going to see how we did. And so for those of you that are trying to get in, we're here, you know, God willing, have the Holy Spirit. But normally our meet and greet is from 7 to 8, but it's whatever the Holy Spirit says. And that's what we're going to do. Amen. So let me get the one song up. And after that, I will open us up in prayer. And we're just going to have a good time. So again, amen. Social media. We would love to meet you, especially my new followers. Some of you come on out. All we need is an email address. That's it. Just give me an email. All you can do is push a button. Amen. Amen. So relax and enjoy the song.
Amen.
I think it'll come on. There we go.
Come on, everybody. Open your mouth and worship the Lord. He's worthy of the glory.
Yes, he is. Oh. Okay, what happened? That's not it. We're not for this tonight, devil. No technique.
Come on, everybody, open your mouth and worship the Lord.
Hallelujah.
He's worthy of the glory.
Yes, he is.
He deserves the praise today. Come on, everybody, all over the room, open your mouth and worship. Lift your hands and bless him in this place.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Do your hallelujah really belong to him? When you say hallelujah, does it belong to God? Woo! Because he deserves it. Yes, he do. He deserves it. He deserves it all. Some of us, we
do. Amen, amen.
You know, God has forgotten. Please, he ain't forget who you are. You're only going through a test of the emergency spiritual broadcast system. It's only a test. Yeah. That's all. It's only a test. Yes. I told them before I came on live, y'all don't know how bad I feel. And I'm glad I don't look as bad as I feel. So it's just a test of the emergency spiritual broadcast system. It's only a test. And it's only going to last for a little while. Amen. Cool. But let us pray. Heavenly Father, I come to you again with my Soldiers on Fire for Christ family and our social media family and those that may view this video later. And we thank you for their lives and we thank you for them abundantly and the lives that are connected unto them, their family and their friends. Lord God, guess what? And we even thank you for their enemies, because the enemies you always allow to become the footstool to take each of us higher, to transform and be all what you created us to be. So Lord, come on in now during our meet and greet session as you always do, Lord God. Use us however you see fit to welcome those that may come in and those that may view this video later, Lord God. Show yourself mightily in and through each and every one of us to let the world know and to remind your people that you are still alive and well. Because some of us are very much distracted, Lord God, because yes, we know there are a lot going on in the world, but we here at Soldiers on Fire for Christ really understand and know you, that we're just passing through. And so we thank you, Lord God, for this day. And also, Lord, I will be remiss to ask you, as always, to forgive each and every one of us for our sins, sins that are known and unknown, Lord God, and continue to help us to remove anything, mind, body, and spirit that is not pleasing in your sight, and even people that we may be connected to help us to remove them, Lord God, if you are not pleased, in the name of Jesus. So have your way in and through us during this time, Lord God, and continue to cover our missing members and our missing leaders, Lord God, Apostle Robin Riley and Minister Von Setter Simmons, Lord God. We love you and we thank you and continue to bless their lives and their family, Lord God, and continue to strengthen them so they can walk and be all what you created them to be. Yeah. So, Lord, we give you all the glory and honor for it now and turn everything over to you in Jesus' mighty and awesome name.
Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise
Hallelujah.
God. Hallelujah.
The floor is open to you. People come in. So guess what? We'll do it like this. Whatever, like we do, is on your heart and mind. We can, that anything you want to say, anything you want to share, do you think that's going to edify us as well as the world?
Praise
the floor
God. Thank you.
Is yours.
Praise Amen. You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
I was just thinking about what you was talking about, Pastor, about pretending.
Amen.
You know, then, you know, it really hit home how people imitating other folks, trying mm-hmm. to fit in and try to be like somebody they're not. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that really hit home. Please, and people, we have a lot of leaders and a lot of leaders that is pretending or imitating someone they not. And like you said, it really bothers me because they not realizing the damage mm-hmm. they is putting on the followers. They mm-hmm. not realizing the damage that they is creating when it comes to those who are following him. Following these leaders. Mm-hmm. So you're right. We need to quit pretending. We need to quit trying to imitate somebody, someone that we're not. Take mm-hmm. off that mask. Go ahead and imitate the person you're supposed to be imitating. That's Christ. But we have so many people out here imitating, pretending to be somebody they're not. So I just wanted to say thank you for the message because it was well understood.
That was a lot.
That
you see, that was a fight. Too many he kept cutting off. Enemy was hot made three times.
Yeah, I noticed that.
And every time he'll ball for me, but he was ball, but though, wasn't he, y'all? He was ball.
Yeah, it was. He was hot under the collar. He didn't want that message to get across.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know why you hot. You gonna go into hell. You should be all right with a little heat under your collar. Mm. Messing with me. He don't know nothing. It's for real. Part two coming out. I was like, I had to sleep that off for 2 days. I was like, you know, jeez. God let me sleep it off for 2 days, boy. God said, he ain't bothering me Sunday. He ain't bothering me Monday. I heard him this morning like, oh, we got work to do. I was like, okay, Father. But yes, people, we got to stop. Come on, people. Come on, especially those of us that are, you know, as I always say, those that have been walking with, because if you're going around telling people that you have a relationship with God and you've been walking with God either all your life or over 5 years, you know what? You need to stop. And it's not even cute. It don't even look good. And the enemy is laughing when he can dangle you like a puppet. He pulling your strings. Yeah. You get out here, you dress up, go to a building, or you come online, and like I say, you got to rehearse. Why you got to rehearse? If you have something to say, come from within and say it. If you really want to do it. It flows easy when you're comfortable in the skin that you're
Praise in. God. Amen.
Jesus was comfortable. I mean, well, he was comfortable being uncomfortable. And the reason why I can say that, because think about it, because he was spirit and he came into a flesh suit. So, you know, this suit probably was itchy-mitchy. He was like, what is all this? You know, because he felt everything. Oh, the humans. Oh, my goodness, their thoughts. Oh, this heart thing. Oh, this mouth thing. Oh, my ears. Because he wasn't. But he learned how to be comfortable for real for the 3 years being uncomfortable for the 3 years of ministry, but the 33 years that he lived. Now imagine being itchy and something, you know, just take your mind and imagine putting on a suit that's itchy. And you had to wear that thing for 33 years. So he's the excellent example, but you know, some of y'all that claim to be, I don't like using the word old, but seasonal believers, come on, y'all. Y'all got to stop. Y'all, it's getting to you. It's we at the end time. We way late. Some of y'all just stop.
What about your mic?
That paper rattling is
your mic, we hear your book. Okay.
Oh, you trying to get his little scripture.
Trying to get it right. That's what.
Bam, that's right. Social media. Trust me. My book got a word for us today.
Oh, yeah, we got a word.
You know, since we started off talking about pretending, you know, come on, y'all. Come on. It's getting old out there. Some of y'all.
Can I say something?
You know what,
I can't get my
I'm
hand
gonna go
to
a little
up.
Deeper. We're going to stick our foot a little deeper in the transparency pool. Come on, politicians. Come on, doctors and lawyers, because y'all will create. God gave y'all those gifts.
Yes.
Come on, teachers and bankers and all that. Come on. Y'all need to stop lying and playing around behind the scenes in your businesses.
Mm-hmm.
See, y'all think, oh, church is church stuff and work is work stuff. No, they still go together because God see all and know all. Yeah. Oh, that's why I said it. And like elders say, take off the mask. Oh, in church, oh, you nice and want to share. But in your business, oh, you treat people mean. You be nasty. Oh, because you just think it's business. God created everything. They all go together. They in sync. Y'all need to stop. I see too many people, even at my job, just stop. Stop being mean. For what? What do you benefit from it when you lay down at night? And then for those of you that's just, you allow the devil to get in and you intentionally plot to hurt people. And then you carry it out. What did you get out of that? Deliberately backstabbing somebody, talking about somebody, hurting somebody. Ooh, you want me to go deep in somebody's business? Some of y'all up here got your eyes. That's your best friend. You got your eyes on his wife. What you benefiting from that? What are you doing?
Your best friend, husband.
Yeah. Or your girlfriend. Yeah. Your girlfriend. Two women, you up here looking at your girlfriend, husband, winking at him. What are we doing, people? How can you sleep at night? How can you come out your mouth saying that's your sister? That's your right. You my best friend. I love you, but you got eyes for her husband or her mate. Really? And the enemy giggling, laughing on the sidelines. Because what he's doing, he's stealing from the friendship. He gonna kill both of y'all, you know, and he gonna destroy everybody. You, the boyfriend, and her. He has his goal. Why would you even fall for that temptation? Minister Rose.
Brother Bud had something to say first. He said he couldn't get his hand raised. Brother Bud?
Yeah, I'll go with it. I know you can help me. I was trying to have Google. I had it memorized. I was reading and studying it the other night. It came across to me. I can't remember. I got so many things, scriptures going. Where it talks about that even though Christ was God and God was incarnated in Christ, he denied his deity on the earth as he, like you said, he wore a sackcloth, you know, bag, you know, that would make you itch, like you were talking about the clothes, it made him itch. It would be like he was on earth, but he denied all deity while he was on the earth. Okay, do you understand what I'm saying? I can't find it. It's there.
No, I know the scripture you're saying, but that's exactly, I just made it, you know, I'm just trying to put it in a way so people can kind of visually and they can audibly hear that when he laid down his deity, meaning
yeah.
Think about if you can unzip yourself and step out of yourself and step into another suit. That's exactly what he did.
Yeah.
He took off the spirit man. He took off his spiritual suit, which contained everything, meaning he was omnipresent. He can be at two places at one time. He could be all over.
Yeah.
He can really just move by the spirit quick. He took all of those attributes. He took that some of the attributes off that was contained in the spiritual suit.
Yeah.
Came through the woman of a virgin through the womb and took on the earth suit, the sin suit.
Yeah.
So you know, he probably within himself, and there were a lot of things, especially as he matured, that he could not talk about to everybody, even though his only friends were the 12 disciples and his mother and all of them, because they understood some things, but then they really didn't. Understood some things until he had to show him. He like, see, then it got to the point, you know what? I'm gonna show y'all better than I could tell you. Now, I told you I was the Messiah. I'm the Son of God, okay? Yeah, some of y'all laughing at me. Some of y'all believe me, but I can see by your actions, like the Bible says, you know them by their fruit. Yeah, some of y'all got half of y'all feet in, but y'all ain't got everything all in, so you don't. So now it's going to get to the point when, as I keep talking about my assignment, it's going to come the time. I'm going to show you better than I can tell you. And guess what? Boy, when Calvary came, didn't he show out? Didn't he show out? They was all shocked. Oh, my God. They beating Jesus. Oh, my. 3 days. Can you imagine? And, you know, of course, like we know with some of the parts of the Bible tells us about, how Peter said he had never denied him. Then he denied him. You see how all of them scattered?
Yeah.
They left Jesus. How you going to leave Jesus? Yeah. He told y'all what was going to happen.
Yeah. Can I say something else?
I don't think, and this is just my opinion, I don't think it's not that they didn't believe. They just didn't take him seriously. And they probably thought that they would have him for longer than 3 years. That's why they probably was like, And so when it happened, I believe back then they was like kind of stunned, like, hold up, he just got here. We only been working out together and serving for 3 years. And
they're still battling with their flesh too.
Because you think about the bond they had behind, just imagine it behind the scenes. Yeah, they sharing suppers. He had a bond, they had a friendship. He was brothers, they loved him. They like, he too young to be dying. And then he came back, and then he had to go again. Brother Bud, Minister Rose?
Yeah, that was another thing, you know, tying in with that. Even up to the, when he was, you know, buried and everything else, they thought, you know, his body was gone. And, you know, it was amazing because he came back through the locked doors. I love that. The doors were bolted because everybody, they were out to kill the Christians at that moment. And the doors were bolted shut. The Bible says they were bolted. And man, I get excited about that because he just appeared here and there and everywhere, you know, but he only appeared at the end of those 40 days. He walked the earth. He came by spirit. He didn't have no more blood in him. You know, that's what's amazing. You know, he poured out his blood. This was the spirit walking the earth. He ate and he drank with the disciples. I mean, the message just blew him away. They had fish fries and all that kind of stuff. But he only met with the ones that were belonged to him. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. He didn't go public anymore.
Not because he wasn't. He couldn't. I believe when you go further to the scriptures, he wasn't going to do that. He only, you know, was going to, because remember before he told them, he told Peter, I'm going to build my church on you. Where he was really telling him, yeah, it starts with you, but it goes with the rest of you. Y'all are the, I'm building what I need. My message going to be built on all of you. And that's why he left the Holy Spirit to be your guide to help you. Meaning when your flesh, because see, this is what he know, and this is what we all experience. When you start going off, doing stuff in your life that is contrary to help you spiritually to grow, and it's going to really hurt you, and it's not going to be edifying for when I was on earth to show you who you are. This is why I gave you the Holy Spirit, to remind you. Who you belong to. Remember what you said. You said you loved God, or you said you loved me. So see, sometimes we only give the Holy Spirit his credit.
Amen.
You have the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. No, I don't give the Holy Spirit his credit. They like, oh, the only time you hear people talking about the Holy Spirit real big is when Jesus left and he get, you know, that's the only segment. But hold up, he's still with us today. Because we see the transformation in all of our lives. We don't even act and do or think like we used to do. Come on, y'all. Give Holy Spirit his credit. And he's still putting up with some of us who, those of you that's backslidden, those of you that's still, you know, seasonal, you over 50 and you still making dumb decisions like you 16 years old. Come on, peoples. The Holy Spirit got a job, boy, to keep reminding you. Put that down. Don't do that. Turn here so you won't get in the car, you know, getting stuck in traffic. Mm-hmm. No, don't spend your money on that. You're wasting, you already got to pay it. You got the same shoes in the closet. That's the Holy Spirit, y'all. Minister Rose.
Amen, amen. I just, first of all, the scripture that Brother Bud was talking about is in Philippians 2:7. Where it's talking about, but empty himself with renouncing or diminishing his dignity, but only temporarily giving up the outward expression of divine quality and his rightful dignity by assuming the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of man, because completely human, but was without sin, being fully God and fully man. Mm-hmm. Now that's the amplified by version, but it reads.
Thank
a little
you.
Different.
That was beautiful.
Yeah, it reads a little different when you read it in the, you know, the King James and other versions, but it's still basically saying the same thing, because it lets us know that he came in the human flesh. Mm-hmm. He took off his priestly hood and held it up in heaven and came down here in the flesh to be in this dirty, filthy world, just to be an example for us. So, you know, I just wanted to touch on that. But since we're talking about pretending so much, and it's sad because there's so many that has today. What can I say? than copy the church. And God, Christ is nowhere in them. And I watch a lot of YouTube because I don't have regular cable or anything like that. I'm not paying for it. I refuse to. But anyway, and they have on, and there are a lot of things that are happening with people that are so-called pastors. And it's unbelievable. Last night I was just overwhelmed looking at down in Houston, Texas, about a pastor that had been molesting someone in his family. They just said family member. They didn't say, you know, what relation. Had, from the time they were 6 years old until they were 16, when she got tired, she told it. He was picking her up, taking her to school, dropping her off, and bringing her back home. And when he does this, he you know, have relationship with her. She named in the church parking lot and everywhere, just messing with this little girl. And I just, for the life of me, can't understand how can you pretend every Sunday or and get up in that pulpit pretending like you, you know, you got it all together and you telling these people what they need to do, but you ain't got it together. It just,
it makes me shake a little bit to hear stuff like that.
I'm sorry. I got to be honest. It burns me up. And the man that was actually reporting, he said, if any of you all children come to you and tell you or anybody in your family that somebody doing that to them, he said, you need to put your foot all the way up in them. And if they say anything to you and want to arrest you, tell them to come to me because I told you to do it.
I know that's right.
I said, Lord have mercy. But I was boiling just to listen to some of the stuff. And my, I have a, I call her my aunt. She's my mom's best friend. And I talk to her every day. She's 95 years old. And she was just saying, me and her was discussing how things have changed in the church. And she was saying how she remembered how people used to respect the church. So in certain things that they would not do in the church house, even if they smoked, they would not smoke on the church premises.
At all. They would be 10, 15 feet away. They'd be down around the corner. You was not smoking. Yeah,
but she said it has come to time now that smoking ain't nothing. She said there's pastors that they found out they got liquor cabinets in their offices. There's pastors got condoms in their drawer. When you open up the drawer, what is going on? You get in front of the people pretending like you've been called by God. You pretended like you teaching them to do something that you don't even do.
Exactly.
And I don't understand, how can you feel that way? I'd rather for you to be like the pastor that wants to sell marijuana in his church and say he forgot to tell his ex-wife that he believed in open marriages. I'd rather for you to be like him, because at least he honestly opened up in front about it, even though it ain't right. But you getting up here messing with these people's minds and their soul, their blood gonna be on your hand, and it just burns me up. I just had to, because we talking about really pretending in the church, and people too. Do it for so long. It's ridiculous. It really is. And when people were pretending in the church, you didn't even know about it. And you hear about it, you know, down the line. Because I remember church I first got saved and I was at. It was a mother in the church. And she, when her husband died, which we thought was her husband, the niece came out and said they wasn't married no way. They had been living together all them years. They old. Wow. And haven't ever got married. And she going by his name and everything. So it's just, I don't know.
Yeah, the enemy doing what he doing. The church
is going to hell in a handbasket.
They sure is. They're going to be on the front row with gasoline drawers on, high parts on fire. Go ahead, Brother Bud, and then Minister Isaiah. You're on mute.
Always am, ain't I? That way it doesn't turn the pages. I got part one and part two. I would like to reread that and come up with the conclusion of what we're talking about. It says in Philippians, that's what I wanted so bad because it was burning inside my soul. It says in verse 5 of Philippians, chapter 2, verse 5. I want to read it like this, okay? I have the emphasis of explaining. It says, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equally with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up all his divine privileges, all that he could take a humble position as a slave. Hallelujah. And was born of a human, like you mentioned, praise God. And when he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal death on the cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all names, that name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will declare that Jesus is the Lord, the glory of God the Father. When you mentioned about how he felt everything, even though he denied all his power, he knew the people's thoughts. Many a times he says, don't you think I know you read my mind. He knew everything that was going on with the Pharisees. He knew what was going on with the church. He knew what was going all over the place, because if I'm not mistaken, he was always in tune with the Father. He says, I do nothing. He told the religious people. He told his own people. He told many people. He says, I do not do anything except the Father shows me or tells me. So he always was in prayer with his Father. And when you were talking about what's going on and all this, I'm tying it up to this by desensitizing the Holy Spirit, which is mighty in power, and blow up the whole earth, the Holy Spirit. And we desensitize ourselves and we rob ourselves from the love that God wants to embrace us with. And with that, I'm past. Thank you.
Amen. Minister Isaiah.
Amen. I kind of felt this one because I'm good. Y'all know me. I'm good for attacking some of the, these churches and stuff, but my heart was just hurting then, right just then, because there's some good ministries out there, too. You know, it is sad. I feel for those churches, those ministries that reach out, walk by God's word, and it really hurts my heart. And I realize a lot of times I get out here, I'm attacking the bad churches because there's a lot of bad ones out there. But I also feel for those ministries who are working hard to save the communities, to help the children, who's not into stealing money, raping, and those attacks, you know. And there's some good ministries out there. And it's so sad that we're losing the churches. People stop going to churches because of these stories we hear about all these ministers and these churches, how these crooked churches, you know what I'm saying? And it hurts the true children of God, you know, because there's some people in these communities that are reaching out to these communities. They're not prosperity type churches. They love the people in the community, but the community got the community laughed at them because there's no more trust out there no more. So for the good few that God anointed that he has out there suffering from these crooked ones, you know, and that really touched my heart when I said listen to that, because it's a lot of people out here, you know, who lost their faith, and they talk the same thing we talking now, that how these preachers and stuff acting, and it's sad, because I tell y'all some of my stories, but I never tell you a story. I have met some good ministers, and some people try to pull me up in the past too, you know, and they fighting hard for their church. They might have a couple of people up in their church or in their houses or whatever, you know. That's why I thank God for Soldier on Fire. But it's just sad. It's hurt my heart because there's a lot of good ministry out there, you know, who truly try to protect and save the people. And Satan just got so much controls on the preachers and stuff out here now. It's just sad, you know. That's all I wanted to say about that.
Amen. Elder Marshall.
God bless. I just want to piggyback on what I just heard so far about how wicked people these leaders are. And, you know, I was listening to Minister Rose talk about how this preacher was doing the child. I wonder what the parents did, because a parent, once the parent found out about how someone was misusing their child, religion or not, I'm gonna take care of business, because you're not gonna misuse my child, leader or not. You're gonna respect my child. You're gonna respect me, and you're gonna honor God. But anyway, I was just thinking about, what did the parent do once they found out? Because this preacher should be locked up. He should still be roaming and misleading these congregations. I just wanted to piggyback on that. Then another thing came to mind. When Christ gave up all, he gave it all up, right? What are we willing to give up? He gave up all. Not just some. See, we don't want to give up some and want to hold on to others, other things. We want to hold on to this little bit, then we want to let go of that, and then we'll give that up, then we want to. Christ gave up all. So what are we willing to give up? We say we're going to give it up, but are we truly giving it up? The word tells us to cast all our cares. You say cast it all. That means give it all up. If Christ was willing to give up the very best thing in his life, to sacrifice for us unworthy folks, why are we not willing to give up things for him? And the one thing he wanted to give, the one thing he wants us to give up is us. Give up us. Move self out the way. Give him your heart. We was talking about, you know, I noticed love was in the air. Love was in the air. Every time I listened to a message, it was all about love. Love. I said, okay, Lord, I see you going somewhere with this love issue, because you is love. You showed your love. And this love kept popping up, popping up, popping up. And we are lacking love with one another. See, when he gave it all up, it was all out of love and respect for his father. Because his father had him on a mission. So when we are willing to give it all up, it's going to be all out of love and the calling that God has on our lives. So I just want to piggyback on that, because that just hit home, because we're not willing to give it all up. We'll give up some, but not all. But God tell us to give it all. He said, give it all. So I just wanted to piggyback on that.
Amen. Amen. Minister Rose.
I just want to say that it's all about denying ourselves. And people don't want to deny this flesh. What this flesh want, this flesh gonna get. And that's how people see it. And that's how they do it. And it's sad when it told us that we have to deny ourselves. Take up your cross and follow me. When it said deny ourselves, that means our fleshly desires, those wants, if they contradicted what God or Christ told you to do, you got to leave it all at the altar and totally follow him. There's no ands, ifs, and buts about it. You cannot think you walking with Christ and you keep doing these things over and over again, and you... And like you said, this went on for 10 years with this young lady. And yes, he has been arrested. That's why the man had to report, and he was reporting on it. But the thing is what I said, over 10 years, nobody said anything. Is it because he was the pastor? And I've seen that happen. People, because it's the pastor, people kept their mouth closed. They didn't say nothing. It's the pastor. It's the pastor. It's the pastor. And the problem is people begin to worship man when you're supposed to worship God. I don't care what church you in. It's all about God. And when it comes all about that man, it's time for you to leave. You better run. Run, Forrest, run. I'm telling you.
Run, Forrest, yeah.
Yes, then you got to do it because it's your soul is at stake. And those that you brought in with you, your family members, your friends, if you brought anybody, they're at stake. You got to, you know, get them up and run as fast as you can. That's all I'm telling you, because there's too much of this stuff is happening. I saw one day where the pastor had an affair with one of the young ladies he worked with, and she also was coming to the church. Got her pregnant. He kept telling her that he was going to leave his wife, and she got fed up with it. I'm telling you, she's pregnant. She went and shot the wife. Now, you tell me, something ought to have been on your conscience enough for you to either leave that wife if you didn't want her and repent and be with the woman if that's what you want. And now you, this woman that killed your wife. Now you got a child out of wedlock you got to raise, and no telling how many he got with his wife. They didn't say, but that kind of stuff just, you know, it burns me up. And we are sitting in church pretending. We pretend because we sitting here telling these folks something out of the Bible, and you ain't living it yourself. So this pretend is hard. Lord, it's a hard pill to swallow when I know that I know I'm not perfect, but I'm trying my best and striving my best to do right. But we got pastors sitting up in the pulpit feeding the flock, and they're pretending. Mm. Lord help. We just got to pray. It's time to pray. It ain't talking about, you know, I'm not telling you to just down and dog. I'm just telling you about it. But it's time to pray. I'm not talking about them just to be talking about them. But I'm saying it's time to pray, because it's time to stop pretending, and it's time to get it right, because time is winding up. Christ is soon to come, and we got to get about our business, what Christ has sent us to do. He gave us all the ministry of reconciliation. You ain't got to be no called to be no minister. You ain't got the call to be no pastor, no evangelist, or no apostle, but he gave us all the ministry of reconciliation. We're supposed to go out into the highways and hedges and compel men to come in, not to sit on our behinds and look at everything happening and then talk about it. Pray about it and go and do what God told you to do. If you doing what God told you to do, you don't have enough time in the day to be watching and wearing and talking about spreading everything what everybody else is doing. What are you doing? What are you doing for Christ? Are you doing what Christ told you to do? So I'm just saying, are we talking about pretending? And these things are coming out in the news in different states and everything and stuff. And it's time for us to pray and time for us to roll up our sleeves and fight and get on a crusade for Christ, because Satan is on a crusade to pull the church down as much as he can, because he know his time is winding up, and he want everybody that he can to go back with him, because he want, which ain't gonna never happen, but he want God to look crazy because he kicked him out of heaven. So we that say we are God's children, it's time for us to roll up our sleeves and get to work in prayer, what they used to call it, neology. Get in some neology. And it's time for you to start talking to these people. You ain't got to have a degree to get us some psychology on the word of God. Amen. I'm done.
Amen. Amen, Brother Bud.
Yeah, I always have to unmute my mic because I turn the pages. Anyway, praise God. I heard that when you turn the pages, it sharpens a sword against the enemy. Amen. I listened to what everybody's saying. It was like Brother Isaiah said, the more that we can put the positive things of Christ out there, the other stuff will fall away. The more that we live for Christ and live a positive life, all the other stuff is going to be like not even exist, because only the light, what is it? The light exposes the darkness. The brighter we get and the darker the world gets, the brighter we'll become when we're in the word and studying. And it says in 2 Corinthians 5, it said, all this and all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us the task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciling. And so we are in Christ's ambassadors. God is making us to appeal, making appeal through us. We speak of Christ when we plead, come back to God. Come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be an offering for our sin, and so that we could be made right with God through Christ. And you mentioned, Pastor, about how he felt everything, even though he was in the suit of flesh. He felt every time he could read minds almost. He knew everything that was going by him. And you could imagine if we read minds, I mean, what would we do? Would we damage people? Want to bury them? You know what I'm saying? If we could read other people's minds. But he was able to do it. And even to the cross, he said, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. They spit on him. They pulled his beard out. They threw him in the ground and his rocks and stuff in his body and his wounds as the cross hit the ground. I mean, I saw that Passion of Christ. And I'll tell you what, I can't ever get that out of my mind, that Jesus was beaten to where it says in history, it talks about he was unrecognizable. He was like an animal. They couldn't recognize him. He was beaten so bad. And we sat there and think, well, he got a couple stripes. The disciples were always whipped for preaching the word, and they just right back in the street again, And when the power of God is in you and you know that you're looking like Stephen, he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the right almighty God. And he looked up there and he says, I see one like the Son of Man at the side of the right hand of God. And when he saw that, as he's being stoned, I don't think he felt very many stones. I felt that he's on his way, and the more that we realize the positive that God in his spirit has given us the power to come forth what we have to give, it makes a light in the middle of the darkness. We don't even really, there is a lot of things. And Jesus said, don't put your head in the sand, but he said, be aware of what's around you, because then when you see that, you know that time is getting closer than it ever used to be. Because if you think, well, just going to church, this and that, but you got to realize what's going on to be able to realize, hey, I want to make sure that my heart's right, because tomorrow I might not be here. And I want to make sure I wake up on the right side of the fence. I'm in 71 now, and I've never thought of eternity more than I have in this last year. That because I can say, praise God, when I, like you said, you raise your hands up when you get out of bed and you say, Lord, thank you for another day. I've been doing that. And it really makes me appreciate Everything that I put in my mouth, everything that I drink, it makes me appreciate that maybe if I was in prison or something and they tried to feed me scraps or something, to be able to be thankful for everything that God is doing in my life. So it's like practicing while we can, because soon the war is coming. And if we're not sharp and if we're not being true to ourselves and true to God, we're not going to be, we're going to fall to the wayside. There's no strength that we have, because our strength comes from the Almighty God, from Him, from the living God that lives in the heavens, waiting for us to, for us. I can see the Father and the Son sitting together, and I can sit there and say, Father, and the Father will say to the Son's looking to the Father. And it's like, Son, it's time. Go get my children. Wow, praise God. I could see that. I could feel that, you know, as we're talking about the positivity of the body of Christ getting strong, because it is getting dark, but we become brighter and stronger because of who He is and not anything we do. It's because of Him. I give Him glory. That's what's in my heart. Amen. Praise God. My hand goes down quick because I can get it. Wherever it's at, I can't find it. I wish somebody could help. I can't find it. Where the heck is it?
Amen. 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 Yeah. What's amazing, though, and I think, you know, because, man, God, I tell you, he's just really amazing. But in this flesh suit, when I talk to Him, because I'm talking to Him from human, so you're talking from the human to a spirit. And I know He understands, because like we already know, because Christ experienced being in the flesh. But now, as He keeps opening our eyes so that we can see, the amazing thing is that the enemy is doing what he is created to do. Why aren't we doing what we are created? The key word is created. To do. So see, this is where I want y'all, even out there, social media, that I want you to really think about this. Let it sit in. You know, we all know the Bible says we all gonna have problems. We gonna all have problems, and guess who fought it was? Eve, who got they got kicked out. So now we in sin. Now we sin nature. So we're going to have problems until Jesus come back and get us, whenever He come back. So we can't use that as an excuse. That's everybody. We already know that. But when you have your moments of hardship, why aren't you doing what you are created to do? Why aren't you using your common sense? Because God created us with common sense before He gave us the word. That's how He created Adam, and they had common sense. He gave us all the abilities that we needed, but we're not using them. And then after He gave Christ, he told us, you know, you're joint heirs, you have power and authority too. Why aren't you using it? That's a common sense thing. And then to accompany it is the word. That's all you need. That's all you need with God. And I keep telling people, serving God is not hard. That's all you need.
But Pastor Teresa, common sense ain't common no more. We ought to know that by now.
We know that, but we don't know that, because think about it, because what we used to do. You see what I'm saying? And look how now that we are reborn, we're born again. And for those that we say, because we're trusting what they say. And I'm talking about those of you believers out there saying they've got a relationship with God. Some of them don't even know the meaning of that word. Because exactly. How can you sit up here and have a relationship with God, but yet you so quick to be so malicious? Or how could you come out of the presence of God and then want to sleep with your dad or niece or nephew, or want to sleep with your sister's husband? How you do that? It's not God. It's not a spirit of God. It's no way. You're not a child of God. You're a child of the devil.
But when I say you cannot
come, you cannot come from all that holiness and you want to think about doing something nasty. Not of God.
I hear you and I understand what you're saying. But when I say common sense, it's not common, you know, outside of the church, let alone these folks that's in the church pretending. Right. Outside but see, of the church, the world,
we need to stop worrying about the outside. The world gonna do what it's gonna do. Mm-hmm. That's one thing y'all gotta do. Y'all gotta stop worrying about the outside people. Look, our job is to do what the Holy Spirit and what God unctions you to do wherever you walk on this earth. He put a word in your mouth to give it to somebody, give it to him. If he tell you to call up somebody and check on them, call them up. If he tells
and that's
you
what I to know. Go this that's, place, I believe that, Pastor. But I'm just looking at the picture as a whole. That's all when I say that. I'm looking at the picture as a whole. But
we're at now. When you look at now that because we're the end time leaders, he about to come back. See, amen. The past has done its done. You see what I'm saying? The world, they keep doing what they doing. Dude. The devil is keep doing what the devil been doing what he was created to do since the beginning. And so now that when we come to the point of our awakening, why aren't we doing what we supposed to do? And guess what? We can't blame the devil. Because you're born again.
No.
See what I'm saying? What we need to do is you and have to be honest. Those you have to be honest not with acting self. With
common sense either.
But you got to know, you got to be honest with self. Because see, that's where it starts with self. You can call yourself what you want to call yourself. You can call yourself a pastor, a minister, all you want. You can call yourself whatever you want to be, whatever fancy word that you want to take out the Bible. The point is, because that's nothing but you, again, putting on a label, but you have to be honest with thyself when it comes to your decision making. Because look, at the end of the day in the life, who is the one making the decisions? It ain't God, it's you. When you get up in the morning, who ties your shoe? Who put on your shoes? You do, not God. He gave you the ability for your hands to tie your shoes, but you the one make the choice because he's not a bully type God. He's not a bully type God. He breathes breath in us. And when your eyes open up in the morning, who chooses to say good morning? You do. You have a choice in your brain to say good morning or even get up and go to the bathroom and go on with your day. See, we got to take people to the basics about church. See, they don't want to see in the whole thing. What I say, people just don't want to be held accountable. They just don't want to be held accountable. They want everything easy. Some people struggle just to walk. Some people struggling just to breathe. So we know life ain't easy. We all got that. Life ain't easy. But my thing is, don't just lay down and give your power of your freedom of choice, that's your power. Don't just lay down and give that freely away or give it to the devil to take over. And that's how he's tearing up your life. You just forgot all about Jesus died and gave you that power. I'm only speaking to those that claim to have a relation. And the reason why I have to say claim, because it goes like we know. It's no way you can sit here and say you a child of God and you in the presence of the Lord. And when you come out, you want to do some evil stuff. It's not a child of God. And ain't no such thing as, oh, oops, it's a mistake. Yeah, ain't no mistake. You it was in your heart to do that. Ain't no mistake. It was deep rooted in there. Some of y'all don't want to own it. Just like when we talk about the little spirits of jealousy and stuff like that, y'all get around certain people and feel a certain way, but you don't know what it is because it's a deep seed of jealousy and envy. That's in there. But then when a situation happens, it comes up. You're arguing with you because we see it in family. Cousins jealous of what? How? You hear the word. You jealous of me. Whoop, that's the spirit. Why should I be jealous and we're coming from the same bloodline? We came from brothers and sisters. We come from the same womb. Why would I be jealous? See, the enemy is good at unifying division. Oh, think about it. He got that down pack, but we don't have unity down pack for us to stick together. See, the enemy knows the principle of unity. Think about it in the story of Baal. They built that tower. They wasn't God's people. They was almost, and God was like, they don't even like me. And they have unified themselves to build a tower to try to get up here. They almost up here with us. Look, and I know God probably, you know, and I told God all the time, I know he was amazed. Of course, we know. But I can imagine him saying, I know he will just rock. I believe God would be so, I mean, all the heaven probably would just be jumping around having a party if it was truly his people who are called by his name could be unified like that to want to build out of their love to stick together to reach all of heaven just because they love God like that. I know he, but you know, he gave us that story to kind of like, okay, if people don't even like me can be unified and y'all had Christ and then y'all had God because God walked the earth before, then what's your problem? Social media, for real, God, that's what God, think about, what's your problem? If people that don't even like you can be unified to plot to kill you, but yet you can't even be unified with those that may, that have shown you and really and love you and want to be with you, something's off. That's all jacked up and off. But it makes you think, though, like, dang, that is deep. See, the devil got his stuff. His plan is on lockdown. All he got to do is get one person to feel a certain way and another person to feel that same way, bring them two together. They have a conversation. And if they're talking about an issue where both of them can be jealous or envious or deceitful or whatever, he can have them plotting and planning to do some stuff to hurt people. And guess what? We see it. Then next you know, we got an organization. And then look how the enemy did Minister Rose. He got real. This is where he ain't really get clever. He just are very observant. He like, okay, because if you look at the scriptures, yeah, he had people, just random people doing stuff. Then he said, I'm a leak over and see if I could whisper in the ear of those that say they're God's people. Let me whisper up in their ear. He got up in King David's ear. He got up in King David at the moment, out on a balcony looking at another man's wife. Just boom. The enemy whispering, you the king. Go on, hit that. Ain't nobody going, you think you the king. Go on and hit that. Just hold up in here, hold up in here. Amen. Brother Bud, it just amazes me. Like the enemy, for real, when you think about it on that, people, whether it's our enemies or if it's Satan himself, oh, he unified. So social media, it makes me wonder why you're not unified with people that really wants to, you know, that are really going in the same direction, especially children of God. Why won't you stay unified? Because some of you, you know, you're in organizations or whatever, but you're what's that word? I don't want to say hitchhiker, but y'all guys say this word, I guess, in sports, like one minute you with this team, and if the team lose, you jump to this team. It's a word because my brother say it all the time. And y'all men say it, like, you are something, something. You are something. Huh?
Trey?
A free agent.
No, it's not traded. It's another little thing for y'all men say with sports. Like, okay, when somebody say, they start cheering for this team. When the team loses, they like, oh, they ain't my team. They want to go with the winning team all the time. And it's y'all say it, y'all men say it. And I got to ask them to say it. Because they say it.
Bandwagon.
Huh? What is it?
And Ben's going to say bandwagon.
What'd you say? He said bandwagon.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're a bandwagon. You're a bandwagon. No, that ain't how I say it. That's not how the sentence is.
Uh-huh.
Say if I think the word is bandwagon, but y'all say y'all men say it all the time. It's not you're a bandwagon. It's something. I think dealing with wagon, you like, because you jump from one ten. How you gonna
say? You're a sellout.
No, it's not sellout.
You're a sellout.
Well, yeah, y'all, it's sellout. But I'm gonna ask my brother to say, because he say it all the time, and I'll be like, but it is true. You always jump in the bandwagon. You 1 minute over here, 1 minute over there.
A bag bond. What do they call that? Bag of bond.
It's something. Go ahead, brother.
That would sound like a bag of bond.
Yeah, but it's a word. Only y'all men use it in sport. Because I've heard only got you when it came to sports time, Super Bowl. And I'll never forget one time because I'm not really, I'm one of the kids out of four. I just don't get football. But my sisters, they was all having a Super Bowl when she was alive. I think we were all at my brother's house or something. And I think, I don't know if it was one of his co-workers, somebody was there and they was like all for one team. And then that's, you know, like, I guess into the game, the person said, you know, start cheering for the other team. And all the men turned around and just said that, I can't believe you're going to come here and be a, and this guy said a word. I'm going to give him the seat. And I, trust me, social media, I get it back for you. But y'all said, y'all missed it. And it was just, it's so funny to me. Help me, Holy Spirit. Yeah, because it's just all my life heard. And I'm like, you know what? And sometimes we like that. You know, one minute we want to be with God, but then when the devil start making stuff looking real appealing, it's like, oh, I want to sample that. And thinking you're going to sit behind God's back, jump ship, and then think that you're going to creep back over back on God's ship. No, that ain't how it's going to work. Because like I said, we all have to help each other, but also help others know that you have the willpower to overcome the devil. See, that's the part. We got to take people back to the basics because some of them don't believe that. They don't believe that they can really get out of their situations or they have the answer be right there in your life. It's a decision that you have to make because God has a part and you, God does not do everything. You know why? Because he's spirit. And right now we're still in flesh. Because if you think about it for real, all today, who was making decisions all today doing what you needed to do? You was. God protected, defended, and provided for all of us today. That's what he did. But he did not physically touch your hand and take your leg and put on your pants and did this. He did not physically sit you down. He did not touch you and start doing your head. You did all that. He did not pick you up and put you in your car and just actually put your hands on it. He didn't do all that. You did that. Brother Bud. You're on mute.
You really got me going there when you were talking about the Tower of Babel and how they joined together. They were talking with each other. They joined as a group. Yes. Like you said, the unity of the body, you know, and they joined together and they said, let us make a tower that reaches into the sky and we'll make us famous and keep us from being scattered all over the world. But the Lord came down to look at the city and the tower of the people were building. He said, look, he said, the people are uniting and they all speak the same language. After this, nothing they set out to do will be impossible for them. So come, let us go down and confuse the people with different languages. Mm-hmm. Then they won't be able to understand each other. Mm-hmm. So we have the Holy Spirit in our life to be able to keep us unified. That is the communication that the Spirit of God has given us with his word to keep us unified. Because a lot of people say translations and this and that and this and that. The main thing is the Holy Spirit leads us to love one another, to completely love one another and let the word work through our hearts. It's like we hear so many different ways, different denominations, different whatever. What the Spirit of God does is build us together with the bricks that we can reach God together. And that way, when we know when he comes back, he will know the people that are his.
Yeah,
I was trying to find out about the sellout. I couldn't find it. I Googled it.
you hit that on the head. You right about that, but like I said, you read that scripture. Now, why can't we get together and say, hey, let's build something, and we're gonna save, you know, we're gonna stick together. Cause guess what? We do have it here. I believe there are, like we all know, they got cures for these diseases. Why aren't they sticking together saying, hey, we're going to get these people healed. Hey, we're going to get these homeless off the street. There are many men and women got the gift of building. And then, of course, I'm just saying, and even like I said, you stretch into the government. I don't see them making a decision saying, hey, with the other country, let's stick together and clean up. Let's clean up our country. Let's clean up these cities, even if we got to do one by one city. But then we so quick to blame that, even though the enemy, so what if he roams? He can roam the earth all he wants. Why is we so focused on him?
Pastor Reese, they do got some cities that making little tiny houses for the homeless so they can go and live in. So they are trying.
I'll tell you that. We need to do more here.
Yeah, they got it in Detroit, Michigan. I know they got it in Detroit, Michigan. It's in Colorado, and then in I think Minnesota.
We definitely got to do better here. Elder Marshall, and then I'm going to go into the chat. I forgot about the chat, people. Sorry, chat people. I wasn't ignoring y'all. I was getting excited. Go ahead, Elder Marshall, and then I'm going to the chat.
Ambassador just went into my thoughts. Oh, shoot.
Let me read real quick the chat, because Ambassador did say if they aren't walking by the truth that's in Jesus, they are lying. Then he said, we will know them all by the food they hold up. My thing went down. And then he said, people who are faking and not walking by the written word will be and are being exposed. Oh, yeah, this is 2024. And when they are exposed, they don't repent. They make excuses. You got that right. That's 2024. God is definitely requiring more. He ain't playing with nobody, none of us. The righteous will repent if and whenever they fall. True. Then he said, free agents, bandwagon. Hold up. What's it? I don't know. It's between, I gotta hear y'all say, y'all get Turn excited, post. Y'all men say that, because people aren't really united by the word as they say. If people love God, they will be united. Absolutely. But it just lip service. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I totally agree. And I'm just so tired, and God is just showing me too much. And I'm like, and it just hurts, because if you got a relationship with God, yeah, I be wanting to fight for God. You know, just like when you see a child hurt, like how the boss said, you hurt my child. You know what I'm saying? So imagine, because even, you know, if God was flesh, trust me, all of us be fighting for God. Don't you be talking about my God. Oh, it'd be gang fights all over the world. Mm-hmm. For those of us, you know what I'm saying? Don't be treating my God like that, as good as he. But we don't even do that now within ourselves, within our own problems. God has been good to us. God been good to me. I'm not going to do this. You only had them type of talks to your own self. And then some of you out there, and I'm talking to social media, some of y'all out there, you say you love God, but your heart is far from him. That means you're not owning, because no one is perfect. You're not owning your stuff. Or you really don't believe. Elder Marshall.
In order for us to be more united with one another, as the Ambassador said, we have to have the love in our hearts in order for us to be united. We have to quit trying to outdo one another. We have to quit trying to be someone we're not, as we go back to pretending. We have to be able to stand together, as you said, and grow. What you say, we're going to grow or we're going to go? Most of us don't want to grow, so we're going.
Yeah.
So in order for us, amen, in order for us to really be united as a core, it said a rope with many strings, a cord with many strings is hard to break. Once we come and unite in the word of God, as the Ambassador was saying, we unite in the word of God, start standing on the word of God, and start building one another up instead of tearing each other down with the love of God in our hearts, we will see more effective things happen in this world. Until we get that knowledge, until we get that understanding and allow them things to start manifesting, it's going to be a lot of division among us. So once we get that love in our hearts, we get that understanding, we start building on the word of God, we start standing and start uniting, it's a sad moment because it's not happening. I ain't gonna say it ain't happening. It ain't happening all over the world because we do have some ministries is united. As Minister Isaiah was saying, it's not all bad out here.
Nah, but boy, they hard to find. It's like finding a needle in a haystack.
It's hard to find.
It's like I'll just say that, Dad, because you know, when Lot had
to question God, right? You remember the story of Lot, right? When he was finished, when God was finished destroying Sodom and Gomorrah, right? He started dealing with God. God, if I find these people, we can save the city. And he thought about it. Dang, I might not find that many. Let me talk back to God. God, okay, if I get this many, will you save the city? And he thought about that. Man, if I'm going, that's just how it is now. We got them out there, but they hard to find.
Yes, hard.
And what if God told you to find so many? Would you be able to find
me? I'd be like, man, you better point. Hard, I said, only I, God knows. I tell him all the time, point me in the right direction, because I'm not gonna wander around aimlessly. Because I could tell you, you know, in my community, it's just hard to find. It really is, and I'm quite sure in y'all cities, y'all feel the same way. So
that's true.
I'm not moving, doing nothing without God. I'm just to the point. That's why I cast all my care. Is everything is on Him and the Holy Spirit. I don't. Even sometimes when I feel myself thinking too much, I'd be like, cut it off, because I know my ability in my flesh. And guess what? I have the ability and freedom to choose. And so sometimes if we ponder on stuff too much, you see what I'm saying? I know. And see, that's what I say. And I tell y'all, and I tell social media and people I'm into, when you want to do your part, you know your weak areas. Stop playing and just work on it at your pace. Stop playing. And then you know your good areas. Keep strengthening them at your pace. At your pace. Stop thinking God is not going to do everything, because He's not man. He's not. He's spirit. He does a part and you do a part. He wake us up. So who choose to set the path of their day? You do. Meaning, if you're out there working, if you have a job, who choose to go to work at that building? You do, not God. God ain't sitting down typing for nobody. He ain't talking on no phones, making no deals. Who does that? You do. He protecting, defending, and providing for you through your decision, all of our decision makings. Because guess what? We can't do that. He watches. He keep us from seeing. While you sitting at a job, He's protecting the whole job, making sure no shooter come up in there and shoot up everybody. He got the angels and can't, you see what I'm saying? See, and you hear it is, you at a safe place doing your work. And what if somebody was plotting that? God intercepted. You ain't coming to that building. My children in that building. See what I'm saying? I got some children up in that building. You ain't coming in there. You know, He protects and provides. So we have to, but our decision making and how we want our lives and what our goals is, God is trusting us. And many of us, all of us done it, we have made decisions that we regret. We have done things we show enough regret. We've hung out with people or connected or was in relationships with people. We be like, why did I do that? Because guess what? God ain't doing. You did it. Whether you listen to God or not, who has freedom of choice? You do. We do. Because God, everything was created by Him for Him anyway. So He don't need freedom of choice. Why? Because He created it. See, some people, they it's hard for them. They some people don't want to hear that, and some people don't want to set that. You know why? Because like we said, some people don't want to be held accountable for their stuff. And even those we see, and it's so sad that are in that say they're in the body of Christ, and how they're deliberately hurting other believers. There are other leaders up here manipulating other leaders. That's so sad. You got two organizations or two leaders serving the same God but competing. Are we serious? But guess what? The devil doing what he doing, because guess what? That's unity to him. He said, yeah, because I unified division. Because I got you don't like this leader and you don't like this one. So boom, the spirit of division involved. Because now y'all competing. See, now I'm in the now he and then he shakes his head trying to taunt God. Now I got your people being unified with me. Because guess what? You know their heart. They don't even like each other, but they say they're a child of you. But they competing. That don't even make any sense. How you going to compete and both of y'all supposed to be serving the same goal? Mm-hmm. And that's sad. And we seeing it. You saying you love the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit, but you mad with me, or you trying to outdo. What is where that comes? And the devil laughing, chewing it up. Yeah, go ahead and get a bigger building so your building could be bigger than their building on the block. Mm-hmm. Go ahead out there and try to get some more members. Go ahead and manipulate and go out here and entertain and get all them, you know, yeah, I'm going to open up a door so your church could be bigger than their church. Y'all mm-hmm. on the same block or blocks apart. Seriously? Mm-hmm. Brother Bud, and then we're going to wrap it up with any thoughts or comments.
Oh, I won't keep it long. You know, it's just like sometimes, I'll be honest with you, different translations of the Bible. If it's not a certain way, it's not the truth. It's not real. You know, to me, what I have in my hand, when I can read it and it becomes alive and I can preach it and it comes alive, it's my Bible. It's the Word of God in my heart. You know, and there's so many people, if you don't have a King James or you don't have this certain kind of divert. The you know version or whatever, that ain't the real thing. You know, I always love my Bible. I love the Word of God. I love him with all my heart, and I really do. And it's just like the King James, if it ain't a King James, it ain't a Bible, you know, and all this and that, and that causes a lot of division. And that has happened in my life, I'll be honest with you. But hey, you know what, I read this with power in my heart. I read it with authority that I see Jesus. I see the Lord working, making the people, building the rocks. And all of a sudden he says, come down and let's tear it all up and change your language. I see it in a vision. I see it happening in my mind. So this tells me that I'm learning about God, no matter what, you know? So that's one of my situation. That causes division too.
Yeah. Well, sometimes we don't think about it like that, but I just want to encourage y'all to continue to love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. Love yourself. Be honest with yourself. You know, you ain't got to lie and pretend. Just be, if you believe and you know who you are and whose you are, and you know without a shadow of a doubt that you are a child of God, your lifestyle is striving to exemplify what the Holy Spirit is saying, with the Word of God and what the Holy Spirit is saying. Because first of all, God already know we ain't going to be perfect. We fall short of the glory every day. So y'all need to get that up out your head too. But hold up, but don't make that no excuse. And I'm saying it for social media, because some of y'all be like, y'all, that's when y'all go into the area of being willfully sinning. God knows my heart. I'm just going to go ahead and keep on, drinking this liquor and getting drunk. Mm-hmm. He know, I'll be all right. No. See, you're taking it for granted. You're taking grace and mercy for granted. You're taking grace and mercy for granted. I want y'all to continue to strive to, when you make a decision, for real, you have to ask yourself, will God be pleased with what I'm about to decide to do? Because guess what? At the end, whatever the decision is, you the one got to make it, not God. When you up against a problem or a situation, you have to make it. God is not going to make it for you, because he gave the ability. He put it in you. Mm-hmm. When you have to make decisions about your family, your children, your wife, your husband, your job, you the one got to make it. So you just need to ask yourself, would he be pleased would he be okay with this decision? Me spending my money this way. Would he be pleased with how I what I'm about to say to my wife? What I'm about to say to my husband? What I'm about to say to my best friend, or do to my best friend, or do to this person who make me mad, I don't like them. Would God be pleased? He too slow. I want revenge for what they did to me. Would he be pleased? Minister Rose, wrap us up. Matter of fact, you can close us out.
I just wanted to, something that Brother Bud said that came to my mind when he was talking about all this. It's almost like it's the competition. Mm-hmm. And everything. And I talking about my aunt, she said that she don't like this. Where they having the battle of the choirs and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. All these sing-outs and all this. She said, we're supposed to be glorifying God and giving God praises, yes. Not to see who can sing the best, yes. Who can do the best moves while they choir singing and all this stuff. She said, it's not of God. And I agree. Yeah.
Because I just said that, how you going to have two leaders, two pastors, we both serving the same God, but you want to compete. Let's buy the bigger church so our church can be bigger than these.
And also the what I was thinking about is I have had somebody tell me that I'm not using the word, the terminology right. When I'm using the Lord, I should be talking about Lord is Jesus and not God. I'm like, well, both of them, my Lord. I don't know what's wrong with. And then somebody else said that his name is a, what's that?
I said the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, they are one.
They one. Okay. Then like somebody else said that I was in a false religion because I ain't no such thing as no Jesus. Mm. It's Yahweh, all the different names that they have, and Yahshua, the Messiah, and all this kind of stuff. Goals.
You know, but I'm telling you, they make my spiritual status.
Are we in the United States of America and we speak English? So if it translated into a J, in the United States, it's a J. It's still the same. God been answering prayer. We've been saying that, so I don't understand when you tell me now that I'm not right. When one day, you was before you got into what you in, you were saying the same thing.
Exactly.
And did not God do?
That's that hoopla. I can't get with that.
But we have to be careful with all that. And that just came to my mind when, you know, y'all was talking about the separation and all this and the different Bibles ain't right. If I can understand it in whatever version it is, I'm gonna understand it. But if I find something that is not according to the scripture in the Bible that I've been used to, see, I raised up on the King James. Yes, I use the King James, but a lot more I use the Amplified Bible, the Living, Bible, what they call the Life Application Bible. Mm-hmm. And I look into all these different Bibles, but if I got enough sense to know that ain't what the words say, because it's been in me, it's embedded in me,
and that's the Holy Spirit. That's his job. Our job is to make up our mind. Social media, our job is to decide if we're going to believe the word of God. The moment you say yes, it becomes the Holy Spirit job. Amen. To get it in and keep it in. Now, all you got to do is say you believe and open up your womb, and he going to put it all in there. You ain't got to do all that hoopla. That's the problem that some of them got, because they do it to show off. And then if you notice, when you're trying to keep trying to do something out your flesh, you get real tired. And then that's how the enemy get in, because then the enemy is, well, you know what? I can prove it to you. Because think about all the ones we see entertaining and acting, and every Sunday they got to do the same act. You get tired. The people, you better, you're going to have to pump the people up. You, okay, last Sunday you did good. You had to pump them up more. Next time, you're going to get tired.
God the already knows that take, in there, you got to do that. All that. If you got to do all that pumping up all the time, the Spirit of the Lord is not in there. Exactly. Because sometimes you do have to usher the Spirit in for somebody that, you know, maybe
trust
going
me, the
through,
Holy, but I'm
but
saying
not
that's the
all
Holy,
the
trust
time.
Me, the Holy Spirit going, you going to know. You know within. We all know when it's the Holy Spirit and when it's not outside.
Amen.
Because
Amen.
For real though, when you know it's the Holy Spirit, you're going to say and do things. Guess what? For real though, your brain wouldn't even have told you, your flesh wouldn't even have told you to say to nobody. And I'm not saying
that's
it always got to be negative, because some of you can say the sweetest things and you'd be like, oh, I sounded so mushy saying all that to my husband and wife. I mean, I love my, but it was a moment that he seen you like, wow. He seen the love that you really have for him, and he heard.
And it don't have to be to your husband and wife. You can, you have
I'm just,
you
no,
can
I'm
give
just using it as an example, period. You
okay.
know when it's the I'm Holy
just,
Spirit.
I know. I'm just saying you, because somebody that don't feel love, you can say some things to them that make them realize that they are love, and that,
exactly.
you know, God loves you, I love you. We family,
and they'll believe
it.
That's what I'm saying. They will. If you are, if the Holy Spirit is in you, and when you're talking to somebody, whether you know them or not, it's something about when the Holy Spirit moves in you and move mm-hmm. your lips, and you listen to him and say what he tell you to say, you can look in that person's eyes and they be like. And sometimes people walk away stunned, but trust and believe, when you discern the Spirit right, they believe what you're saying.
They be like,
but see, that's when the Holy Spirit part come in, when y'all separate.
Amen.
Like, boom, because now that you done said and did what I told you to do, boom, the seed is planted. Now they going back to their house like, wow, I just talked to Minister Rose and she said a powerful thing to me. She told me that I'm loved and I never thought that I was loved. Oh, you may not see that person. I've had that experience, but I've seen people do that. I've had that experience with people from me as well as for other people as my journey. And I'm like, what? And it taught, because I'm like, guess what? It wasn't the person. It was the Spirit speaking right there.
Amen. Amen.
Because,
and that's
why? Because they were in an agreement to be obedient unto the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that's the same way with the Bible. If you believe God's word, all you got to do is be open, and the Holy Spirit going to take all them scriptures and it's going to be right up in here. You
Amen.
May not can't get the, trust me, you may not can't get the whole sentence and commas and all that and who said what in the red, but guarantee you what, every spirit connect, every spirit that you interconnect with. And guess what? That's why God gave us these devices, so we can look up the scriptures. You got the ability to look them up and be like, I know it's in me, but here's the exact. But you be giving them the meat and they be like, wow, he knew what he was talking about. That is in there. Even though, and then the way that God used, because that's why he created us all different, because our personalities. Your personality in that moment was the hook to bring them in. And then when you show them the word, they really lighten up. Like, wow. Brother, you being transparent and taking your time and being so nice, like you said, Minister Rose, and loving to me and talking with me. Dang, he's right. That is God's word. It's right here. Undeniable. So to say all that to say, we just have to continue to, we have to know our places and keep balance. Don't try to step ahead of God and the whole, don't try to step ahead of the Holy Spirit. When you're going throughout your day in life, you know, always include them. Thank you, Lord, for waking me up. Okay, God, well, you already know I got to go to work today. Come on, get in the car, go with me, guide me. And if you need to interrupt me, because guess what? You're working to do something, I'm available. I'm available. Because sometimes on the job, he interrupt me. Put that down real quick and go over there and talk to you, your coworker, or go over there and help them. One time he caught me off guard like that. And I'm like, I was trying to finish up something. And I'm like, because the computer was just acting up. I ain't feel like doing it all over, you know, or staying late. I'm like, help. Come to find out, though, I did it. But at first, I had to get my attitude because I was like, I'm trying to go. Went over there. Guess what? Once I went over there and talked with my coworker, boom, it was, we were helping each other out and we was able to get out on time. I said, gotcha. He said, yeah, he, and
you
he talked,
and
he said,
together,
yeah, you about to catch your attitude. you know, he tells me, look at you, catching an attitude with me. I helped you save 20 minutes. So you ready to shut the whole computer down, which had made you stay late. And when you went over there, because guess what? See, I didn't know. Y'all had the same problem in a sense. I was like, God, it's bad. Brother Bud, and then I'm going to give it back to Mr.
Rose. Like, we were talking about unity. We're talking about harmony. Harmony is like music, right? You have an orchestra and everybody is just the horns, the drums. Yeah, and it's harmony. Harmony. Could I imagine what the music in heaven sounds like? Wow, praise God.
Everybody on one. Oh, my goodness. When everybody on one accord. See, that's why the devil don't like us. But that's why he can use music stronger. Because he was trying, I'll tell you, he know how to get us through music. Because we all been, so all we need is a beat. We don't even pay attention. That's why I always tell y'all, listen to the words. Y'all know we had listened back, back here in Maryland, it was this song called, it was called Chicken Box. Chicken Box and a Half and Half. And me and my sister was talking about this, my sister in Philly, and we was like, who sit around talking about it? I mean, it was just a silly song. The song made a hit for a little bit. And it just didn't make any sense, the words. I'm like, and here we was jamming to a song talking about a chicken box and a half and half. No, what got you was the beat. Everybody was going down the street. Yeah, and then you get a chicken box and a half and half. You what? You associate it with the song. You singing it. Getting it. But yet, the person, I believe it, I don't know if it was a rapper or whatever, wasn't a believer, all jacked up. But boy, we was jamming to the, you know, chicken box and a half and half. You just think about stuff, because it's, and that's how he's so slick. Is he'll get the music. He gets you with a beat. You ain't even think about no words. Because like today, now I'm gonna be honest with you. I loved R&B because I listened to words. You know, we listened to the old school, oldie but goodies, where the songs made sense. You know what I'm saying? Even if it was a love song, it was, the singer had a reason. If he was going through a broken heart or whatever, that's what you knew. He had the lyrics made sense. Now songs today, I don't know what they talking about. I'm like, and the rap too. Remember the old school rap? Some of y'all know it made sense. Some made sense. Now I just hear a bunch of noise. What are we saying? I'm like,
there's no beat to it.
I was like, what is they saying? But you get a beat to make people move. You're like, what they talking about? I mean, like you said, Minister Rose, we all speak in English. Why can't we understand this? See, the enemy real slick. Any last comments, anything you want to share? Doesn't have to be on this topic at all, but just something on your mind, heart, you just want to share real quick before Minister Rose closes us out and pray and wrap it up. This has been I knew this was going to be one of those somber meet and greet. And for those of you out there, because this year, 2024, God is truly requiring more of his people. And we all got to be honest with ourselves, and we all know, and we can all see with the signs of the times. We all, and I'm talking about those that are with me, because I can't say for all, because I don't know everyone in the world, but those that are connected to me, family, and those that I know, and those that do, I mean, use their common sense. We know that time, you know, the world is really, it's a sad and bad and dreary. It's just, you know, everything is all messed up. It is, you know, we're going to eat. We got to own that. We got to eat the cake on that. Government all jacked up. the leaders all jacked up. Not everybody. I'm just saying what we're seeing, and sadly for us here that are spiritual and we do have relationship with God and striving, and those that we may see that we may know that are other believers and they're not right, and those that backslidden, all jacked up. And guess what? We can't be feeling sorry for them, because guess what? They know the same God we know. Our job is to try to help them, if God says, point them back to the direction so they can be like, you know, you tell them, come on, you gotta get back on track. They don't want to get back on track. You're going to have to just pray for them and say, God, you know, I did what you told me to do, but they refusing. That's when the Holy Spirit be like, oh, okay, not a problem. It's my part now. It's my turn. You know what I'm saying? You did your part. Now it's my part, because the Holy Spirit gonna get it done, and you know we already know that he'll deal with each and every one of us. But I just don't want, you know, those of you that I know, you know, because sometimes we all have those heavy moments, and yes, just the atmosphere alone can bring a heaviness on you, because like we know stuff jump, yeah, spirits jump, bring a heaviness on you. Just strive to stay focused, and you strive to, you know what your life is about, where you're headed. You just stay focused on that. Love everybody. Yeah, like we know, even our enemies love everybody. But you still have to be mindful and have balance, because guess what? We're in this thing called flesh. We not spirit. We flesh right now. You know what I'm saying? We're spirit and an earthen vessel. But we live our life more out of this flesh, because we make decisions, we have family, we've had kids and stuff like that. So we're spirit and an earthen vessel. So you have to, we got to really be mindful of our connections, our decision, every little thing. Because enemy, he's just lurking and watching. One decision, that's all he needs. He just need one crack. He need for your little eyes to start looking at something and it's appeasing. And he starts seeing the desires on your face about it. And sometimes we get antsy and want stuff, and you know you're gonna try to ease on in your head and like, go on, get it. Why you don't want it? Or why? Or go on. I mean, y'all just friends. That's your homeboy. Why is you trying to make moves on your homeboy woman? Cause see, sometimes you pay attention to stuff. I don't know where this come from. Somebody out there, y'all better stop. Cause I done said that 3 times in this meeting. Y'all better stop looking at those that you say that you care about, whatever, and you letting the devil bring up your lusting eyes, or you having inward desires for something that you're not supposed to have, and you know it. Don't be looking at that like that. Don't be coveting no other woman, especially sisters too. Don't be covering your best friend's man. Don't be doing that. That's nasty. Don't have no thoughts like that. God not pleased with that, you know. Don't be doing that. You see, you may think it's innocent because you ain't said it or no one know, but God know, because he know your little nasty thoughts and heart. Don't do that. That's disrespectful in the presence of the Lord. Don't let God see no crap like that. See, because you have a choice. Don't do that. Don't disrespect God like that. Single people, trust me, wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. He got somebody, trust me, God is somebody for everybody. Wait on the Lord. If you don't want nobody, that's fine too. Wait on the Lord. Murray folks, so y'all, some of y'all struggling, cut all that struggling out. Because see, y'all struggling in y'all flesh with each other. God ain't nowhere in that. Include him in that, and all that struggling will stop. All that struggling will stop. All that bickering, all that tug of war will stop. Because some of y'all bickering and struggling over stuff for real, though. If you really think about it, y'all going to sit back and laugh at each other like, this is so dumb. What are we fussing about? This is dumb. I'm walking around mad. We pouting at each other. Don't want to speak and say good morning. Seriously? Seriously? And the devil trying to kill us and our family? And we going to let, because you mad because I didn't put my shoes up. Well, come on, peoples.
Gotta dismiss.
Come on, married couples, y'all gotta do better. Yeah, we got a few more minutes. Is that Brother Tyrone with your hand up?
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Oh, that's Brother Tyrone. All right, Brother Tyrone, amen. You got the last word, and for real, I gotta give it the minister.
all, everything she was talking about, it's like all you was mentioning about, if you seek the Lord, if you seek, just say you pick up your Bible and you make your make the Bible your a priority first in your life. And you go study from Revelation to from Genesis to Revelation. You just go through it, find out about God. I would tell anyone, start from Genesis, find out about God. God is the creator of the world. And then go to Matthew's where you can accept the Lord Jesus as the savior of the world. And then go get baptized. And then just pick up your Bible. Start from Genesis all the way through. And everything I noticed, my friends, as I've been doing, that's what I've been doing. Everything that the way I live, like marriage and friendship and job, my job, even my kids, even my new kids, my grandkids, even my choices now. You know, when you follow God, you won't have so many situations that you have to choose not to do this. Because when you're walking in God's way, it's like holiness. It's like the presence of holiness, the presence of good, not bad. So the choices be more easier because it will be all good choices. You won't make so many mistakes when you're just seeking the Lord. I'm telling you, with all your heart, like you said, seek me with all your heart, soul, strength, and understand. Your whole life, lay your whole life down. And everything, my friends, what the gospel would do to you will prepare you for this life. Even a life that you once lived, it'll prepare you to not go in back into it, even give you understanding about that life. And then, and as the new life, be blessed, man. So my life is being blessed by the word of God. I ain't had to buy it. I ain't had to go pay nobody to get it. I just had to get in the word of God. I became a better man. I became a stronger believer. I got to really understand who God is and why did God give us these scriptures to give us the strength to trample over all this wickedness, even teach us. I'm listening to the Bible and I understand now what he mean by the light because everything's much clearer now to me. The wrong I shouldn't do. I used to do wrong things. I ain't never understand how bad they really were. You know, the things I was doing. We never understand how bad they really are, but how come now when we follow the gospel, when we believe in it, when we have it sealed up in our hearts that God, the gospel gave us a new mindset, like you said, in the gospel, even say, creating a clean, you have a good circumcised heart.
Clean heart.
And then your mind. And I tell you, my friends, I didn't know it was going to be this way, but I love how it prepared me for this life, preparing me to go out into the world where there's so much evil, go out and prepare me to live each day, seeking the Lord, staying in his presence, doing the things that, like you were saying, do the things that please. Well, I'm telling you, everything that now when God show you the way, you see that everything he's showing what you do, it makes your life better, but it's pleasing to him. It makes your life, we let God transform our whole life to desire him, to seek his words, believe in his word, don't doubt. And everything that pleases him make our lives better. It's all for his glory. It's all for his glory. But I tell you, my friends, I keep on because if loving God is going to make me happy, loving God and then being obedient to him going to make my life in peace and joy every day, Lord, no stress, no, you know, and that's what the Lord said, I won't give you much as you can bear. And I tell you, he already know in his words, you won't get much as you can bear because his words humble you and you'll enjoy to serve the Lord. You enjoy to listen to the Creator speak through his gospel. You'll enjoy as the Lord done put these scriptures together. He orchestrated the whole thing from Genesis to Revelation, a mighty God. You understand that he did it all. And you know he did. You know what? Man can't come tell you nothing. Oh, no, this man just control you. The devil is alive. Man ain't got this kind of compassion. Man ain't got this kind of understanding. Not no man that I used to hang around. Not no man I used to know when I was once in the world. I tell you the truth. And then I hear about that man, even when the truth is being told to this man in the world, even in the Bible, they are blind of the truth. They're blind and they accept the truth, but not in their whole heart. You know, I understand now. We can say, oh, I accept you, Lord, but by your actions, you denying him every day. You following the kings and the queens and the presidents, but you say you love the Lord. But by your actions, you deny him every day, and I don't want to live that life. I listen to the Lord, and I hear his voice. Let the Spirit lead you every day. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let the Spirit of the Lord lead us every day. Minister Rose.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Before I go into our prayer, let me give you a little announcements. I'll try my best not to be long, but I just want to remind you all to join us this Thursday at 7 o'clock on the prayer line. You can check any one of our pages or either the group page, Soldiers on Fire for Christ, is pinned at the top. The number for the prayer line, and also on Friday this week, we will be having Bible study, and our minister Isaiah Robinson will be the teacher, and on Saturday Bible study, our Pastor Teresa Vinny will be the teacher. You can email either one of them. You can message either one of them via Facebook Messenger your email address so they can make sure that you be a part of this class, either one of their classes. Amen. And also, I would like to just briefly remind you of the St. Jude fundraiser. Amen. We have partnered with the St. Jude Foundation to raise $1 million for these babies, and we're asking you all to give. We've been asking you all this almost a whole year now. We're asking you, and we know that you all have spare money that you can give. You know, we St. Jude's asks for a minimum of $5. You can give $5, but if you got more, do so. If you go to either one of our pages, we will have the St. Jude fundraiser flyer on there. And at the bottom of that flyer with that little boy in that green shirt is, it will say stjude.org, and under that it said just because. Mesh on that. When you mesh on that and click onto it, it will come up with different dollar sign amounts. And those different dollar signs amount, if you decide you don't want to give the ones that they suggest, there is a other down in the right hand corner. You can push that, and if you push on that, you write in the amount you're going to receive. And you can give anonymous, or you can give your name. We're asking you to please help these babies. These are they all babies. I don't care how old they are. You know, they have them. They go up. You know, some are teenagers. But we're asking you to dig deeply, because these children, they need money for medicine, research. They need money for their parents, the room and board. They house these parents there so they can be there next to their children. And we're asking you to dig deep into your pockets and give that extra coffee money, that money you was going to give to McDonald's or Chick-fil-A or Sonic's, whatever restaurant you like. Think about the babies. Keep some back for them. I'm asking you to please to you know, give, and that when you push that done button, you send it goes directly to St. Jude. It do not go to Soldiers on Fire for Christ at all. We don't see none of this money. This money is going directly to St. Jude's, and they will directly send you an email saying that they have received the amount that you have put in there. We don't take no portion out. We know that when the Gomi Fund, they have to take out a certain percentage. They take out, and all these other places take out. We're not taking out any thing. It goes directly to St. Jude, and St. Jude would distribute the money in the places that it need to be distributed. So we're asking you to not give to Soldiers on Fire for Christ, but give to these babies that need it. Amen. These have been your announcements. And at this time, we're going to close out in prayer. We just ask that you would just govern yourself accordingly to the announcements as we leave one another. Amen. Oh, Heavenly Amen. Father, oh, gracious God, we come to you all this evening, oh, God, asking you, oh, God, to bless us and keep us, oh, God. Lord, help us, oh, God, that we won't be pretenders. Help us that we will be about your word. Lord, that we will put on the whole armor of God. Lord, that we will not, hallelujah, glory to God, be backbiters, oh God, that we will not go around criticizing, but that we will, oh God, be about your business, oh God. When we're doing what you called us to do, we have no time to backbite, to criticize, oh God, but help us, oh God, that we will be more like you as we walk in your word, oh God. And not in flesh, Lord. And we just thank you and we praise you, oh God, that this taping, this viewing on tonight will reach somebody out there in social media, oh God. Lord, I ask, oh God, those, oh God, hallelujah, glory to God, that they will take a look at the man in the mirror, that looking back at them, oh God, and that they will, oh God, recognize that they need, oh God, to change and to put on the whole armor, God, and to walk in your word, oh God, and stop pretending, oh God. And we just thank you and we praise you and we glorify you all tonight, oh God. Lord, I ask that you bless us, oh God, all of us as we lay down to sleep, oh God. And Elder Marshall, as he goes to work, oh God, I ask, oh God, that you would be with us, oh God, until we all come together again. In your holy and righteous name, we do pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.
May God bless you all.